Today is not a sermon on love, but it's a very encouraging word. And I don't know who this is for, but I really feel like it's a timely word. I think it's either for someone who's going through something, just went through something, or about to go through something. But I just want to stop by here this morning and encourage you that nothing takes God by surprise. Can you turn to your neighbor and say, nothing takes God by surprise? Whatever is happening in life, God already knows about it. So we're gonna go to two primary scriptures this morning. If you want to turn your Bible, we'll get there in a moment. One is Jeremiah 29 and 11, and that one is going to be from the New International Version of the Bible. And then we're going to go to Romans 8, 28 from the New King James Version of the Bible. So if you find those scriptures, I will be referring to one other scripture in Psalm 139. But other than that, you'll have all the scriptures for today's sermon, okay? So we're going to talk about nothing takes God by surprise. There are going to be days in your life where you get surprised. Anybody ever been surprised by life? I didn't plan on this happening. Anybody ever said, I wished it had not have happened? Has anyone ever said, what am I going to do now that this has happened? There are things in life that happen that absolutely change everything. You can never be the same again. People mourn all kinds of losses. Mourning is just not about death. Mourning is about loss. And so you can lose a job and go into a state of mourning. You can get sick and lose mobility of a functionality of your body and go into a state of mourning. People can move away. You can lose a friend or a good neighbor and go into a state of mourning. Life is filled with all kinds of crippling, emotionally crippling moments where we didn't expect something to happen, and then we're wondering how we're going to make it through. I'm certain that Faith and I are not the only couple in this room that thought we would die a few times along the journey because of heartache and pain and disappointment and betrayal and things that you don't see coming, and then when it happens, you realize that you have to make it through. Sometimes it's people dying. I'll never forget the day I buried my armor bearer. I wrote a book years ago called Armor Bearers, which was our bestseller, and I wrote it about an 87-year-old man. At the age of 67, he came to me and said, I just retired and God assigned me to you. And he told me to never let you go into a battle without me. And my job is to bring you back alive. I said, what do we call this, Dave? He said, I'm just going to be your man. I said, I don't like that. We got to figure out something else. I don't need a man. We got to find out something else to call this. We didn't even know what to call it. He started traveling with me. He's literally gone to most of the continents of the world with me traveling. He's probably gone on 40 missions trips with me at different times. He stood in front of a swarm of wasps that came into a building one time when I was preaching in El Salvador in an open-air meeting, and a swarm of wasps came into the building, and Dave, my armor bearer, stood out in front of them so they would sting him instead of me. He was about 78 years old, and when they got right near him, he just stuck out his little bony finger and said, I curse you in the name of Jesus. And listen, this man wasn't a preacher. He was a layman. He was a retired truck driver. But I watched that swarm of wasps go around me and attach themselves to the pulpit, and they died. We scraped them off with a putty knife the next morning because a man of God said, I will not let you go into battle without coming back alive. He told my wife every time I left town, I'll bring him back to you. Don't worry about it. My job is to bring him back alive. And I wrote that book on armor bearers about him because he taught me everything I know about armor bearers. But I have to tell you, the hardest day of my life was when I had to bury DJ Haynes. I thought the man would live forever, and at 87, I had to put him under the ground. And I walked away from there thinking, I'll never be the same again. And I've missed him every single day since that day. Life is filled with disappointments. Sometimes your plans will fail. Anyone besides me ever had a failed plan? Maybe you've had a failed business. Maybe a failed relationship. Maybe a friendship didn't work out. Maybe a marriage didn't work out. Maybe something with your children didn't work out the way you thought it would be. Life can be filled with disappointments, but I have good news for you that even when life surprises you, none of that surprised God. He is waiting in the wings to pick up the pieces because he is the one that said that he would always be there for us. You know, there's this doctrine called predestination that people get all mixed up and they exchange it for another doctrine that I call predetermination. It's almost like that God's playing a chess game with our life and we have no choices. I believe that we do have choices. And I believe that when we make a choice, God already knows the destination. So predestination doesn't mean I don't have a will and that I can't make a choice. But whatever choice I make, if I go left, he is there. If I go right, he is there. If I go straight ahead, he already is waiting on me there. If I back up three steps, he's waiting on. If I fall, he'll catch me. It doesn't take God by surprise. I'm told that an amateur chess player always thinks three moves ahead of their opponent, but a professional chess player thinks 30 moves ahead of their opponent. If he moves here, I'll move here. Can you think if a professional chess player knows 30 moves ahead? Think about an omniscient, almighty God. If I make 50 mistakes, he knows the outcome already because he's already got plan 51 in place to catch me and put me back on track. So I know that my destination is in his hands, even when I make mistakes and wrong choices in life. That is why I love this passage in Deuteronomy chapter 29, verse 11. So you can look there with me if you have your Bibles. It says, "For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord." Now, notice who said this. Declares who? Somebody tell me who said that. Declares who? The Lord said that. God said, "I know." Now, if I told you that I know the plans I have for you, well, you would say, "Well, you don't know me very well because I can change my mind." But I'm not the one who said it. God said, "I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future." You see, if I'm the one who said that, then you would be in trouble. But I'm not the one that said, "I know." The one that said, "I know," is also the one that said, "I am." The one that said, "I know," is the one that said, "I always know. I'm omniscient. You make three mistakes, I've got four answers to put you back on track. Every time you turn, I am there to move you in the right direction." You have to understand, the one who said, "I know the plans I have for you," is the creator of the universe. See, I don't know about everyone in this room, but one thing I do know, I know about God. And when you know God, you know that even on your worst day, he is still on the throne. You know that even when life lets you down, that he is still there to catch you. You know that even when you have made a mistake yourself and you cannot swim out of the mess you've made, even then he will pick you up and wash you off and put you back on the right path and set you on the course of destiny that he planned for your life. Oh, you can give up on friends, but don't give up on God. You can give up on people, but don't give up on God. You can give up on somebody that left you, but God said, "I will never leave you nor forsake you, but I will go with you to the ends of the earth." You may give up on presidents, and you may give up on governors, and you may give up on governments, and you may give up on kings, but there is one you should never give up on, because he is the creator of the universe. You see, God is a burden bearer, and God is a life transformer, and God is a mind renewer, and God is a way maker, and God is a body healer, and God is a church builder, and God is an on-time God. Hallelujah. God is a lock picker. He's a mind settler. He's a nerve quieter. He's a load lifter. He's a gift giver. He's a storm calmer. He's a wind stiller. He's a wave walker. My God is a promise keeper. He's a covenant maker. He's a demon chaser. He's a debt payer. He's a mouth stopper. He's a yoke breaker. You may give up on people, but don't give up on God. He's the one that put the shine in the moon, the fire in the sun, the twinkle in the star, the red in the rose, the fish in the sea, the seed in the grape, the banana in the peel, and the corn on the cob. He is the one who did all of that, and he can come through for you. Can you give God praise this morning? Hallelujah. Don't give up on God. For he's the one that said, "I know the plans that I have for you." What kind of plans is he talking about? I know. So we talked about the I. We talked about him knowing. How about the plans that he have for you? I don't know how this works, but I do know this for a fact. You are not a body that has a spirit. You are a spirit that lives in a body. Your body can deteriorate, but your spirit can be strong. You can be racked with disease and still be a spiritual giant. I've seen sick people pray for other sick people and them get healed. I've seen crippled people pray for crippled people and them get healed. No explanation as to why they didn't get their healing, because sometimes we are treasures in earthen vessels for the glory of God. Sometimes that happens. But here's what I do know, is that there's more DNA to you than you know. My wife and I, at Christmas time, decided to give each other the DNA test. It revealed to me what I already knew. I'm a mutt. I knew it before I ever took the test. I have European, I have Asian, I have African, I have everything in me. I mean, literally, it's like I'm a mutt. I just got everything in me. But it also, because she was adopted, we didn't know what she was, it revealed what I always knew in my heart, that she's 98% Irish. And that's a good thing as far as I'm concerned. And 2% American Indian. Go figure that. That's fighting blood right there. Irish and Indian. I don't know how that came about. But that's DNA. We didn't know what DNA she had. I didn't even know what DNA I had until I did that. But can I tell you, there's more to you than your DNA. There's more to you than your hair color and your eye color and your stature. And if you're tall or short or thin or thick, there's more to you than all of that. Can I tell you that God has DNA inside of you? And when you activate your faith, when you stir up the gift that is in you, it stirs up the God side of you. You become supernatural. When you begin to act supernatural, you become supernatural. There is a God DNA inside of you where God said, on the day you were born, I'm going to declare certain things over your life. He told Jeremiah, he said, in the matrix of your mother, I declare that you were a prophet to the nations in the matrix of your mother. He told Isaiah also, he said, I called you from the womb to be a prophet to the nations. So God declares things over your life. I love this passage in Psalm 139, for it says, your eyes saw my substance being yet unformed, and in your book they were all written, the days fashioned for me. Can you get that? The days fashioned for me. You know, when you get to heaven, you're going to see this volume, this huge library called the books of life. I know that when you read about the book of life, sometimes it's almost like that song we used to sing when the roll is called up, yonder I'll be there. It's according to what part of the country, how you say yonder. But it's like we think that the book of life is a roll call in heaven. No, that's not what the book of life is. The book of life is all about you. There is a book of life for you and for you and for you and for you. There's a book of life for me. There's a book of life for you. Every one of us have a book that's been written about us by God and also been transcribed by angels. There are scribe angels that follow us around. We call them guardians, but they're really taking notes. There are scribe angels following us around, writing the story of our life and lining us up with the destiny that God had planned for us. Well, I don't want angels writing down everything I did, but you got to go over to Colossians and read what he said, that when you come to Christ, he said that he took away all those things that were written against you. He nailed them to the cross and washed them away by the blood of the Lamb, and that page is blank. So when you get to heaven and they tell the story of your life, all the bad stuff is left out. It's just the good things that you did. The righteousness of God shines forth in the book of life. Well, part of this book is what God said about you, those plans. I have plans for you. And listen to what he says. And in your book, they were all written, the days fashioned for me, when yet there were none of them. God says, there's things I want you to do. I have plans for you. And the only way you can discover those plans is to discover me in you. You cannot discover those plans by going to a college counselor and saying, let me take a career test. You cannot discover those plans by going online and taking your temperament test. You cannot discover those plans. Even you have to discover those plans by discovering the maker of those plans. And in a relationship with God, he draws you in to him himself and makes you into his image, into something that you don't even know that he had planned for you. Do you realize that there are people right now in this room that you are in seasons of preparation, and you don't know why God's got you learning the computer? You don't know why God's suddenly given you an interest in reading when you never had one before. You don't understand why you're learning certain skill sets, why all of a sudden you want to take up the guitar when you never wanted to take up the guitar. And by the way, you guys are awesome over here on this band. Listen, there are people that are doing things right now. It's like you got a notion, you don't understand the notion, and now suddenly you are doing things that you don't even realize why you're doing it. See, one person can change your life. One phone call can change your life. But before you can walk into destiny, do you know what destiny is? It's a collision course where preparation meets opportunity. Because if you have an opportunity and you are not prepared, you cannot walk that path. So God prepares you, and God says, even though you don't know the plans I have for you, you're preparing for something in your future that you don't even understand right now, because I'm giving you certain skills, and then I'm going to pull the veil back and reveal my plan, and you're going to say, wow, I am capable of doing this. I can do this. I was ready for this season all along. I didn't know I was ready for this season, but I really am, because God has been preparing me. So God says in his plan, he said, for I know the plans that I have declared for you, plans to prosper you. How many of you are happy about that? Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope in the future. Well, how is God going to prosper me? Well, he told us that in Psalm 23. And I don't have time to preach this whole sermon, but you know Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod, thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest the table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness, mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. So how is God going to take care of me? Remember, Psalm 23 takes place in the valley of the shadow of death. So how do you, it didn't say it was a valley of death. It says it's a valley that looks like death. It's not, you're not going to die in the valley. He said, yea, though I walk through the valley. You're going to walk out of the valley, but in the valley, you think you're going to die there. So how, where is that shadow coming from on the valley of the shadow of death? Well, that's Psalm 1, that's Psalm 23. So you have to back up one psalm to see, because a shadow in a valley is created by what? A mountain, right? So we're looking for a mountain that's casting a shadow in the valley. So if you back up to Psalm 22, here's what it says. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? You remember those words? That was Jesus on the cross. So what is the mountain that's casting the shadow on Psalm 23? It's Mount Calvary. And it looks like it's all over. Sometimes you're going to walk through seasons of your life, and it looks like you're going to die in that season. It feels like you're going to die in that season, because here on the left side, when the sun's coming up in the morning, there is a shadow cast from Mount Calvary that looks like a cross. It looks like death. It looks like it's over. But just hang on, because 3 days later, you sang about it this morning. 3 days later, he rose again. You just have to keep on walking to the valley, because here's what I know about the sun. The sun rises in the east and sets in the west. So that means there's another shadow going to be cast later on in the day. So in the beginning of my journey, when I'm walking through the valley, all I see is the cross, and it looks like death, and it looks like it's over. But if I keep on walking through the valley of the shadow of death, after a while the sun is going to start casting a shadow from another mountain on the right, because the sun is going to set in the west. Well, what's on the right side? Well, if Psalm 22 is the mountain on the left, then Psalm 23 is the valley, then Psalm 24 24 is the mountain on the right. What does Psalm 24 says? Lift up your head, O ye gates. Lift up your head, ye everlasting gates, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord God, strong and mighty. You see, what is that? That's Mount Zion. That's the mountain of victory. So if I keep on walking to the valley of death, and the Lord is on my side, and if I can sing the song, if it had not been for the Lord who was on my side, where would I be? And if I sing the song that he will see me through the fire, that he never promised that my cross would not get heavy, but I keep on going, then on the other side I get to live in victory. And it's there in the valley that he reveals something to us, that if I will keep walking through the valley of the shadow of death, then I will fear no evil. If I keep walking through the valley of the shadow of death, he will prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. If I keep walking in the valley of the shadow of death, he will anoint my head with oil. If I keep walking in the valley of the shadow of death, he said he's going to give me two companions to get me through the rest of my life. Here's the plans to prosper me. I'm going to give you goodness and mercy to follow you all the days of your life. All you got to do is stay in my presence, and goodness and mercy will get you there. Goodness walks before me. That's why I walk into good things. Mercy cleans up the mess behind me. Mercy means you don't get what you do deserve. So when I'm walking in the goodness of God and I mess it up, mercy says, keep on going, boy. I got this. Keep on going. Mercy's going to take care of it. And God says, the plans I have for you are to prosper you and not to harm you. They're to give you hope and a future. Goodness and mercy are going to make sure you arrive to Mount Zion, and victory will be yours. Can you give God praise? Hallelujah. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you. Plans to give you hope. Boy, hope can get you through, can't it? I love Lamentations 3. He says, I recall this to mind, and therefore I have hope. Through the Lord's mercies, we are not consumed. Can anybody give an amen to that? It was God's mercy. I should have been consumed, but the Lord was on my side. But through the Lord's mercies, we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. And then I love this part. Great is thy faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. As long as God is on the throne, as long as goodness is in front of you, as long as mercy is behind you, the way you find hope is you don't stop. You just keep walking, and you just keep pushing through. And when you do, there's a guaranteed success in front of you. Anybody that's ever overcome something and now you're living in victory, can you just put your hands together right now and thank the Lord for that? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, Pastor Bryan, I'm so thankful for this promise, but what do I do when something bad happens in my life and it looks like my plans have failed? Well, let me tell you, your plans will fail. It looks some of the plans you make will not work out. Your plans will fail. My plans have failed many times. I've learned as much in the school of hard knocks as I have learned anywhere else. And so your plans will fail. So what do I do when my plan fails? You reach into the Bible and you say, okay, God, you said, for I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you. Plans to give you hope in the future. And it doesn't look like this is happening right now. It looks like it's falling apart on your watch. What's going on now? And God says, don't worry, I've got another plan. He said, here's the plan, Romans 8, 28. And we know that all things work together for the good to those who love the Lord, to the called according to his purpose. And can I tell you something? That even when life is falling apart, something good is still going on around you. You may not see it. You may not see plan B. You may not see the supernatural acts of God. But I promise you that God is not silent even when you can't hear him. That God is not motionless even when you can't feel him, that God is not distant even when you can't sense his presence. He is always there. And sometimes when we look at God, we think because God is light that if we can't see it, that God is not in it. And I don't know why we use this metaphor, but we've gotten addicted to it in the body of Christ, where we make light God and darkness the devil. So anything that we can't see, we blame it on the devil. And sometimes it's the mysteries of God. You have to understand that the Bible says in Isaiah 45 that God created darkness. Somebody started a rumor that's not true. They said that darkness is the absence of light. And that's just not true. Before anything existed, there was only light. There was no darkness. In the beginning was God. In him is light. In him he moves and has his being. In him, God is not dark. God is all light. So before he created anything, there was nothing but light. The first thing God said is, let there be light. He took a part of himself and threw it into the universe and created the universe out of that command. So it was all light. But the Bible reveals that in Isaiah 45, that God creates darkness to conceal his secrets. So the darkness is God concealed. The light is God revealed. Don't give the devil credit for anything. He is one being. He's not omnipresent. He's not omniscient. He's not omnipotent. He can be one place at one time. His biggest gift is that he is a liar and a deceiver. Do you realize that God made the universe, but most of the universe is dark? Most of the universe is dark. God's got secrets out there that he's waiting to show us at the right time. Can I tell you, as much as you know about God, you can trust him because there's so much more you don't know about him. He's bigger than you ever thought he was. He's greater than you ever thought he was. He's more beautiful than you ever thought he was. He's more majestic than you ever thought he was. So even when it looks like the plans are not working out, you can be sure that God has another plan. 1 Corinthians 13 and 12 tells us that we look through a glass darkly. That means I wish I knew what was going on. I cannot see but one side. But you know what the other side of that reality is? There is another side. There's a supernatural world and there is a natural world. And even when it doesn't look good in the natural, it's still looking good in the supernatural. You don't know how many angels are following you around. Can I tell you something? Don't worry about demons chasing you because the entourage that's with you. Ask Elisha's servant when Elisha said, "Lord, open his eyes." Now, what do you see? He said, "This is all I see. Those who are with us are more than those who are with them." Can I tell you, on your worst day, when it looks like the devil's in your boss, and hopefully you're not the boss, but if it looks like the devil's in your boss and or maybe climbed into the voice of the secretary, on those worst days when it looks like all hell is falling apart and your neighbor's cussing you out and you got the notice in the mail that something's gone wrong and it looks like life is falling apart, remind yourself, this is not the only reality. There is another side of reality and my God is in control and there is a supernatural world that rescues me and is coming to my aid. I'm only seeing part of the picture, but I know the plans that God has for me, and all things will work together for the good to them that love the Lord. If I love God, if I keep worshiping, if I dwell in the house of the Lord forever, if I keep on walking, something good is going to come out of this mess. I don't care if I made it. I don't care who made it. No weapon formed shall prosper. Every tongue that rises up, thou shalt condemn. It's the heritage of the servant of the Lord. You will overcome. Several years ago, when my first daughter went to Lee, my second daughter was still at home, we decided that we would go visit Brittany in school there at Lee, and we lived in St. Louis. So we head out. We were missing her. I think it was around February. There was snow on the ground, and we were driving to Lee just to visit with Britt for a few days. And so Faith and Lindsay and I had gotten in our car, and we just stopped to gas up, And we got back in the car, and it was just like out of the blue. You know, you got, I have all daughters and four granddaughters, so I get this. And if you have a bunch of girls around, you get this too. We'd been in the car about 10 minutes, and somebody said, oh, I'm so sorry, but, you know, I drink too much water, and, you know, so there you go. And so I said, really, we just stopped. And so it's like, well, we need to stop again. So we stopped again, and this time, you know, I don't have to gas up or anything. I just pull into this little convenience store, and Faith and Lindsay go out and get in the store, and there's this little lady that pulls up beside of me in her car. It wasn't a really nice car, just an old car, and this lady pulled up beside of me, and she was walking in circles around the car, and she was saying, the vision, something's wrong with the vision. It was like she was disturbed and a little confused, and maybe a lot confused. And she was saying, the vision, something's wrong with the vision. And I heard her, and she's like right beside my car. And I'm thinking, okay, I probably need to help her. So I got out of the car, and I said, ma'am, what's wrong? The vision, something's wrong with the vision. The vision, something's wrong with the vision. And I said, maybe you need windshield wiper fluid. That's all I could come up with, right? It's like, it's snowing outside, you know, maybe your wiper, maybe you can't see out of your windshield. So I popped the hood of the car. I happened to have, you know, in St. Louis in the wintertime, you keep that in your car all the time. So I happened to have the good stuff that doesn't freeze, the blue kind, you know, and I pour it in her car, put the lid on there, and I slammed the hood down, and I was going to say, now go in there and try it. But before I could, she grabbed my hands, which scared me just a little bit. I mean, I knew I could beat her up, but I didn't want to, you know, but she grabbed me by the hands, and she said, she looked at me, and when I looked at her, I saw eyes like I had never seen in my life. This lady had the bluest eyes. It was like looking inside of her head. And when she grabbed my hands, and then now my eyes are as big as saucers, and she says to me one thing, God's getting you ready for what he has ready for you. And I said, what? She said, God's getting you ready for what he has ready for you. And I said, would you wait right here? I want my wife to hear this because I'm a nut magnet. I'll be honest with you. And they all find me. If anybody's nuts, if they're crazy, they'll find me because I'm a nice guy and I'm not going to push them away. I'm a nut magnet. So don't tell all my friends I said that, but they know it because they say, man, you know, you get all the crazies, Bryan. I'll love them anyway. And so I'm thinking, okay, my wife, she's got the spirit of discernment and she's also a redhead. She'll figure this out for me. So I want Faith to meet this lady to find out if she's legit and if those are contact lens, you know, because I'm like hooked in. And so Faith and Lindsay are walking out of the convenience store. And I said, honey, come here, I want you to meet this lady. And she laughs at me all the time. She said, what are you doing? Why are you acting silly? Why are you outside the car? I said, because this lady. And I look, there's no car. There's no lady. And all I did was this. I mean, it wasn't like 10 minutes. I just turned around to see them coming out of the store. And I turned around. There was no tracks beside of me where a car had been. I'm standing there holding this jug of, it's half full. I've poured it out somewhere. And I'm holding this. And I got in my car and Faith says, what's up with you? She knew something was wrong when I went a solid hour without saying a word. That has never happened before. And when I didn't talk for a solid hour, she knew I was either dying or dead and still driving or something had happened. And then finally I spoke and I told her what had happened. And I said, the Lord sent an angel. I wish you could have met her. She just looked like a little old lady in an old car. She didn't look like an angel, but the Lord sent some messenger from heaven to tell me this. God's getting you ready for what he has ready for you. And I said, I don't know what God's got ready for me, but I know that I'm in a season of preparation. And I stayed in that season of preparation for a long time. And now I believe I'm doing what God had ready for me that he appointed in my life to do. I believe I'm in that season now and I'm walking out that path. But can I tell you something? God's got a plan. And I love the passage in the Bible that says that we should not forget to show hospitality to strangers because in doing so, some have entertained angels unaware. You don't know. There could be an angel here this morning. They're everywhere. They literally are everywhere. Even if you can't see them, I believe with all of my heart that every person in this room has seen an angel. They might not have had blue eyes and wings and halos, but I believe you've seen an angel. Some of you are convinced you married one, right? So, what? No takers? Man, you're in if you said amen. You're in. Did you get that? I threw you a bone and you didn't even take it. I did. So keep in mind, everywhere you go, they're all around you. And God has a plan. I don't want you feeling alone. Because here's what I know, that on the hardest day of your life, he is there. On the most difficult season of your life, he is there. When you get the worst news you could possibly get, you're just going to walk through that valley. You're not going to die in that valley. You're going to walk out of that valley because God has a plan. Peter was in prison, and a guardian angel had already been sent from heaven. They were praying for him to escape, and they're already there. You know why? Because the Bible says that there's camping angels in your yard right now. Camping angels, really? Yeah. Haven't you read that before? It's the truth. The angels of the Lord encamp round about those who fear him and deliver them. They're just sitting there roasting marshmallows if they have those in heaven. If my book says they do, but they're just sitting there roasting marshmallows waiting on your enemy to show up. They have nothing to do but rescue you. That's all they're there for. The angels of the Lord encamp around about those who fear him and deliver them. They're just sitting around your house pointing their finger at every demon that walks through the neighborhood and says, not this one. No, there's blood on this doorpost. Not on this one. Jesus is Lord here. Not on this one. And every demon and imp of hell that wants to come in your house, they stand in the front of the door and say, no, this one's been anointed. This one's been spoken for. There's prayer that goes up from this house. The Holy Ghost dwells in this house. You're not going to touch the children in this house. You're not going to touch the family in this house. This is a blessed house. This is a house that's protected from the Most High King. They're encamped round about you for one reason only. They're there to deliver you. And unless you get in trouble, they get bored. So when you get in trouble, they get active. My help comes from the Lord. God is at his best when life is at its worst. I'm going to ask the musicians to come. Many years ago, when Faith and I were let me tell you the quick version of the journey. We started out at a little Church of God in St. Louis. It was around 52. It was our first 3 months average, 52 people. And the church started growing, and the Lord started blessing, and we outgrew our building, and so we sold it, and we ended up moving 18 times. Yeah, it's better tell than felt, I promise you. It's easier to tell than to live through. And We were setting up, and we were in gymnasiums, and the church kept growing. To our surprise, we were on this amazing supernatural journey that we couldn't even figure out ourselves, because it was defying all the laws of church growth. We weren't doing anything right, and yet God was blessing us anyway. And we had grown up to probably 1,000 people at this time, and we were meeting in schools, and we were desperate to get a building. We had bought this place called the St. Louis Soccer House. It was an indoor soccer house, and it had four bars in the soccer place where the people would, you know, gamble and they had pinball machines and all. I mean, those, that kind of establishment. And while they played soccer, it was not children's soccer. It was grown men. And it was a rough place, but it was a great big building. And it was in foreclosure, and so we purchased it because we could afford it. And the county said, wait a minute, we're about to lose all this tax money from this 501c3 that just moved in there, this not-for-profit church. They're not going to be paying us any taxes anymore, and they're going to lose a lot of money. And the county said, we're going to freeze them out until they have to sell it to somebody else. So they sat on it. They came and they put chains on the front doors of our church and would let us in, would not give us an occupancy permit. Now, we had already paid for the building, and we're making payments on the building, and we're still meeting the school. Well, every Sunday I would have to face the music and tell the congregation. They said, are we getting in, Pastor? And I got so tired of the question, because a year went by. We're still not in the building. Locks on the doors. A year has gone by. And I just don't even want to go to church anymore because I got to say it every time. I'm so sorry. We haven't been able to make any headway. We had to have 32 signatures from the county, from all kinds of departments before we could even get in the building. And they had the place on lockdown. I went into a state of depression as a result of this and went on a fast. And on this fast, I said, okay, God, you got to come through because I'm losing my mind here. I'm just a kid pastor from Georgia, actually. I graduated in Georgia and I'm raised in Tennessee and Georgia my whole life. And I'm out here. I don't know anybody. I don't have any pull. And I need your help. And the Lord said, I want you to take your congregation to Gilgal. Honestly, I didn't even know what that meant. I've written a book on Gilgal since then, but I didn't even know what it was then. And I thought, okay. So I got out the map. There was no Google in those days. And there you go. Age again. Got out the map. I could not find Gilgal, Missouri anywhere. Because I'm thinking, okay, we're going to sell this building. We're going to move to Gilgal. There's no community. 157 municipalities, not one of them called Gilgal. And I thought, okay, what do we do? And I remembered Gilgal in the Bible. I opened my Bible and I remembered how God took this circle of stones and they dedicated these stones to the Lord and they built an altar and consecrated the people and God healed the land and God healed the troops, the army. So I went to the congregation on a Sunday morning and I said, I'm going to do something tonight that may get me put in jail and I want you to know about it. I'm going to cut the locks off of one of the doors because God has instructed me to anoint an altar inside of that building because this land is under curse and it's got to be free. And God wants me to go in there and he wants me to anoint the land. And I'm going to go in there. So if you see me on the front page of the papers tomorrow, you'll know. And I said, you're welcome to come with me, but I didn't know if I'd get any takers or not. That night, about 800 people showed up with lawn chairs. And we all went through this door and we set up, we didn't even have electricity. We set up generators and a little praise team and we worshiped for a while. Then I had 11 elders. I still remember this because I gave them all a cement block and each elder would lay down a block and kneel and pray over it and pour oil over the block. Then the next elder would come and we built this triangular looking altar with those 11 stones. And then I had the final stone, the 12th one, that rounded it off and it was for the future of the church. So when I poured that oil over that 12th stone, I had a whole gallon of oil and I poured it over the stone and they were singing in the background and I was just praying and all of a sudden this storm came over the building that was so deafening we couldn't hear anymore. It drowned out our PA and all I remember thinking was, wow, we're going to have to put a lot of insulation in that building. I mean, that's all I could think of. I'm thinking, oh my goodness, we didn't know that. This storm was, I mean, it was horrendous. It was a huge storm. And it was lightning and thunder and raining so hard. It sounded like the roof was going to cave in. And some of our kids had just gotten back from Winterfest. And they had left their luggage outside because there was no rain. They left their luggage outside because the bus dropped them off there instead of at the school where we'd been meeting because we were all over there. And so some of the kids ran outside to get their luggage out of the rain. And this group of young kids come in the church and they're crying in the building and they're crying and they're hugging each other. And one of them yells out, I think it was Matt Clark was the guy that did it. He yelled out and said, Pastor B, there is no rain outside. There's only rain inside. You can hear the rain inside, but outside you can't hear the rain at all. And I couldn't hardly believe what he was saying. And I went outside. There was no rain. There was nothing was wet. There was no water on the ground. It was dry. I walked back inside and I heard a storm in the building. But I'd walk back outside. I mean, it was the most supernatural thing we had ever seen. And we, that night, we knew that God had visited with us. And we knew that something, I've never been in a moment ever in my life like this. And I didn't even know how to lead through it because all I could do is say, woe is me, I am undone. That's all I could say. I've seen the Lord, he's high and lifted up, his train has filled the temple. That's all I could think of. And the whole place was just filled with the glory of God. And we worshiped and then we went home and we didn't know what to do. And about 3 days later, I get a phone call from the county commissioner. His name was Buzz Westfall. He calls me at home, and I was downstairs praying. I still remember it. It was on a Tuesday or Wednesday morning. I was downstairs praying, and Faith comes and says, "Honey, the county commissioner is on the phone for you." And I said, "Oh my goodness, he found out what we did." Because he was the guy. He was the guy in charge of it all. He found out what we did. So I got on the phone. He says, "This Dr. Cutshall?" I said, "Yes, sir." He said, "I haven't been able to sleep for a couple nights." And he said, "All I think I could think of this morning was this, there was this lady, a CP, that helped me make a lot of money, and I never did her a favor." And he said, I need to clear my conscience. So I called her and said, "Listen, I need to do you a favor because I haven't slept for two nights, and I need some sleep. Can I do you a favor to clear my conscience for that?" And she says to me, "This is the county commissioner. Don't do a favor for me. Do a favor for my pastor." And she gave me this phone number. "So, sir, is there anything I can do for you to clear my conscience so I can go back to sleep?" And I said, "Well, I need 32 signatures from the county to occupy my building." And here's all he said: "Can you be at my office in an hour?" We have been trying for over a year with no success. "Can you be at my office in an hour?" And I said, "Yes, sir." I got me an empty briefcase. I put on my suit and tie, and I walked into the county seat, Clayton, Missouri. I walked in there looking like somebody. I went in empty, but I came back full because he called in every department head. That man had a temper. God didn't say he was going to send an angel to do it. Sometimes he used the devil to do his handiwork. That guy had a temper and used some foul language that he should have never used in front of a pastor. But he called every department head, and they were all in cahoots together not to let us in the building. And that man would slap his hand on the table and say, "I said sign it," and then use a few other words I can't say in church. He said, "I said sign it," and they'd sign it and leave the room all mad, and then call in the next guy, and he would do it 32 times. I witnessed that. I was shouting like this under the table. He had no idea, but I was giving my Pentecostal shout all under the table. 32 times he handed me, he said, "Will that do it, sir?" I said, "Yes, sir." And that's still the building Twin Rivers is in today, because we walked out of there with the glory of God on our favor. When life is at its worst, God is still at his best. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I don't know who this message is for this morning, but here's what I know. I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope in a future. This is what I know. We know that all things work together for good to them that love the Lord, to those who are the called according to his purpose. You can give up on people, but don't give up on God. You can give up on a dream, but don't give up on God. You can give up on a plan, but don't give up on God. Because God is here this morning to let you know his plan for you is to walk on through it to Zion and live in a place of victory. I'm going to ask you to stand this morning. I'm going to have two prayers. The first prayer, I just want to stay where you are as we pray. And then the next prayer, I'm going to call for the prayer team, the care pastors, and all the prayer team and staff that come to pray with you normally. Here's the first prayer. I'm going to ask everyone to close your eyes, if you will. What a beautiful crowd this morning, completely packed all the way up to the balcony. Beautiful crowd. But I know even though we're in church on a Sunday morning, that there could be someone here this morning who's never fully committed your life to Jesus Christ. So I'm going to ask everyone, if you will, to just honor this moment. Just close your eyes and bow your head for a second. No one looking around. I want to give some privacy to those who just need this moment for themselves. If you're here today and you say, "Pastor Bryan, I've either been running from God, or maybe I've never even surrendered my life to God for the first time, or maybe I have, but I've just been kind of playing around with it. I really haven't fully committed to living my life for the Lord." If that's you this morning, why don't you just slip your hand up and down? Would you do that? Just slip your hand up and down. Thank the Lord. 1, 2, keep going. Just keep going. I see those. 3, 4. In the balcony, 5, 6. Just keep going. That's all right. We're good. We're good. 6 people so far, maybe more. 7. There's another one waving at me there. 7. I want to give you a minute here. I need to completely surrender my life to God. 7, anybody else? There may be others that just say, you know, I'm not ready to do that, but I want to hear the prayer. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to lead the congregation in a prayer of surrender together. I know you're saved. Many of you are saved, and you probably prayed this prayer a long time ago, but I want you to pray it with those who are praying it for the first time or maybe the second or third time, because today is the day that they fully commit. You know, my dad was a preacher, and I went to the altar so many times, I'm not sure which time stuck, but one of them did. Sometimes you just have to go back again and go back again until you realize one day you wake up and you're living in God's presence like a Christian. So right now we're going to pray this prayer, and I'm going to ask the whole congregation, you guys in the microphone, just go ahead and say this with me in the microphone. That will just help us lead the congregation. Let's pray this together. Father in heaven,
Father in heaven,
I come to you in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
And I admit, that I have sinned.
That I need a Savior.
And I believe
that
Jesus Christ
died for my sins.
Come into my heart.
Live inside of me.
And help me to live for you.
And now confess
that Jesus Christ
is the Lord of my life.
In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.
Now I want us to celebrate with every person who just prayed that prayer and meant it this morning. Praise God. The angels are rejoicing. We bless your name, O Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm going to have one more prayer call, and I'm going to ask those who normally pray with you in the altar, would you come and help me this morning? Just come and stand here with me. If you're on the care team and if you're on the ministry team, just come and stand, because there may be others here who say, Pastor Bryan, I know why the Lord gave you that sermon. I'm in a place of transition, maybe a place of despair. Maybe you're just in a place of confusion. Maybe you're just at a place in your life that you're just trying to figure a few things out. And you don't know what that looks like yet. Maybe you're trying to find a new job or buy a home, or you're trying to find a new relationship in your life, regardless of where you are. Or maybe you're where I was when I was in a state of depression. You know, I don't mind telling you that, because Elijah the prophet dealt with the same thing. And it was just that moment of hopelessness. And you might be there. Maybe you just got some bad news, or maybe you're dreading some news and you just want to fortify yourself for it. Wherever you are, up in the balconies, all of the back of the church, as they sing this song, I'm going to ask you to get out of your seat and come and let somebody pray with you. It doesn't matter who you come to. Just come to someone here and let them pray with you this morning, because God's plan for you is to walk out of that valley. You will live and not die. You will succeed. You will prosper. He doesn't want to harm you. You will prosper. So if you will just step out on faith this morning all over this room as they begin to sing this song, just come and bring it to the Lord. We bless your name, Lord. Hallelujah.
You come.